at Alexandra leave?
I saw her in the restroom.
Oh, okay, because I thought she had left her thing earlier. Okay. And I'm curious, it's kind of interesting, it depends who you listen to on stuff. You have to be careful. This is an article in the Sun Sentinel last week, and it said that big box stores are, you know, vacating, but it's creating opportunities for smaller tenants that wouldn't otherwise have an opportunity to go into bigger malls. So these large operators are taking 40, 50,000 square foot footprints and dropping them into 10,000 square foot, you know, sort of larger retail center environments for some of the smaller inline guys. And it's working, so I don't know who to believe. There's things happening in retail. I think Jordan's going to tell us a little bit about that next week. The last thing I wanted to mention, I get a newsletter once a week from a mortgage brokerage firm in California. I have no idea why I get it, but I get it. It must be because I'm subscribed to something. And what I like about it is it just kind of gives me a sense. They always highlight two or three recent transactions that they've done. So this kind of lets me think about what deals are in the market, what kind of conditions are in the market. And ultimately, this is all about discovery, informational and price discovery. So it's very difficult for us to, you know, have a serious negotiation with a bank, with a life insurance company, with a conduit if we don't know what is available in the marketplace and what we can push. So food for thought. Now these are, you know, the collection of these week after week after week help you formulate ideas, okay, in addition to what you're living or talking to other people. So, you know, one newsletter a week does not. You think maybe Channel 4 wants to interview me or something? I don't think so. So, you know, one newsletter does not informational discovery make, but it's definitely something to start on, okay? And so here was one. $19 million acquisitioning and repositioning in Seattle, okay? The loan that was given was a 36-month plus two 12-month extensions. What's the first thing that tells me? 36 months on an acquisition. 36 months plus two 12-month extensions. What does that say to you? Daniel, what does that say to you? Well, it's not construction. It's not construction. Is it
36 months?
Yeah.
It's going to take 5 years.
What's going to take 5 years?
The acquisition process.
An acquisition takes a day. Boom, you sign the papers, you record it, it's yours.
The returns.
What interest rate?
Okay, I think you're all beating around the bush. You all got a little bit of it. Is what this tells me is it's not a stabilized asset, because right. If it were stabilized, it wouldn't be a short-term loan. Right. That's number one. Number two, what's the interest rate on it? 30-day LIBOR plus 450 basis points. LIBOR, floating rate, typically more risky. But why do you need to have that? It's a short-term loan. So you're matching, right? But again, so the first thing I'm looking at this, without having read anything, I haven't read this yet, I'm reading this out with you, I already said this is an intermediate, okay, loan, okay?
450.
Amortization, 36 months, IO. What's IO?
Interest only.
Interest only. Okay, again, why interest only? By not stabilized, not throwing off enough cash, okay? 30-year amortization thereafter. Well, there may not be a thereafter because it's 36 months plus two extensions, okay? Loan to cost. What do you think the loan to cost would be?
40%.
You probably, if somebody, here's my take. If somebody's going to loan you 40% on something, it's not worth giving up your...
The
60%. It would sound more like 60% to me, okay? Because again, it sounds like it's riskier than a stabilized asset. 70%. Prepayment, 18-month lockout. We'll talk about lockouts in another session. Thereafter, subject to a half-point exit fee, so a prepayment penalty. We'll talk about call protection in a little bit. Guarantee, no guarantee, so totally non-recourse. That's one of the basic tenets Daniel, when you talk about debt, that's one of the basic tenets of real estate financing, okay? So this is a value-add multifamily asset within one of Seattle's trendiest neighborhoods. That must mean it's junk. And, you know, trendy means up and coming, it's going to be in the future, you know. So anyway. Yeah, so. Here's the next one. This one shocked me. $7.5 million pre-development financing on a predominantly vacant West Los Angeles office and retail building. So the first thing I think about when I hear pre-development and vacant land, what's the first thing that jumps to my mind? Well, I would start with probably no more than 50% loan to value. Okay, now, this is the first land loan I've personally seen in some time. I would tell you up until about 2006, 2007, land loans were relatively prevalent in South Florida. Typically with personal guarantees, typically no more than 50% loan to value, okay? And typically very short term in nature. And it was typically a lender that you had a relationship with that would loan you the money so that they could essentially get their foot in the door to then do the construction financing, and they would wrap up, then they would wrap the land around the construction. The last thing, I personally have not seen a pre-development or a development cost loan in decades. So I've seen construction loans, okay, that are for hard costs associated with vertical construction. Loans for soft costs, okay, pre-development costs, I personally have not seen in decades. And we had a huge problem with that in this country in the 1980s. So but what this is telling me is wow, people are assuming a tremendous amount of risk. Now, interest rate, 9.5% fixed on this. So in relative terms, somebody's expecting a return for the risk that they are assuming. Interest only, 18 months, so very short term, okay? What really shocked me here is 75% loan to value. And I would have to say, I haven't read this, this cannot be from a bank, because a bank, let me see if it says who it is. A national debt fund. We'll talk about shadow financial institutions. You know, this whole thing, we've talked about disintermediation of the financing process. A bank could not do a 75% loan on land, so it has to be a non-traditional lender, okay?
National debt fund.
National debt fund. So, 12-month interest with an interest reserve. It's crazy. Anyway, so, what does this tell me from this week? Lenders getting aggressive. What does that tell me? Too much money chasing too few deals, yeah, over any value. So people are putting money out there. Did you guys hear, those of you who went upstairs, there was a question asked at the end in regards to, if I knew then what I know now, or if you knew then what you know now, would you have done this business? And the guy, what did the guy say? He said, I'm not in a position in life to take as many risks as I used to. Right, okay, it was three deals. Okay, you're right. So you had three deals, which one would you take? And he was like, but basically what he said is, what we teach in this class, what's the risk reward profile of what you're looking at? I mean, the answer, if you would ask me, and they asked him the question, he wasn't prepared for it. My answer is an easy one. Do a projection on all three, calculate the IRR, right? You know, let's take a look at financial assets. That's what we've learned here, right? Let's forecast a net present value. Let's calculate our cost of capital. Let's discount it back, right? And then in the context of capital budgeting, those of you who've taken a third year, undergraduate finance class, in the context of capital budgeting, it's very simple. If your net present value is greater than zero, What do you do with an investment? You make it, you do it. Why? Because you're recovering your cost of capital and then some. In fact, at zero and beyond, you undertake an investment. Now, there's many capital projects. There's always more projects than you can do. That's why you use IRR, because it lets you choose between multiple projects. So in the context of multiple projects and limited capital, what does corporate finance tell us? Very simple. You take the highest of the internal rate of returns that you have available. So I mean, that's the answer I'm going to give it. But then you interplay, okay, what's the risk that I'm going to assume for that return, okay? And I mean, I think he answered the question properly, and I definitely can relate, as I'm getting older, to, you know, the issue of, you know, that he brought up. I sent all of you an updated case study assignment schedule last Wednesday. So next Tuesday, we've got office markets, we've got retail and retailing, and we've got hold versus sell decisions, okay? And I've gotten your outlines, I've now gotten your outline. That's it, I think, okay? But, you know, starts, did you send it? Okay, but you know, you guys, those are, so we got people on deck, we got people in a batter's box, essentially. You're hot. We got people on deck next week, and we got people on in the hole the week after that. So if you're on deck or in the hole, it's time to start moving, okay? Okay, last week we were talking about, we had the whole, do you have a question, or you're just,
who?
Oh, come? Okay.
Okay?
Oh
my God.
Last week, the whole sort of discussion was around debt. We didn't even get to debt because we started with interest. And what was interest, right? Just as a refresher, what was interest?
Fisher's Law, right?
Well, that was one of the things. So Fisher's Law dealt with what?
Real interest rate, nominal interest rate.
Well, the part you're missing is the important part, which is the effect of rising prices or the loss of purchasing power and their effect on interest rates. And so, if I remember correctly, without looking at my notes, we said that nominal, what is nominal? Nominal interest rate was what? That's, nominal interest rate is the stated rate of interest, right? Okay, so nominal is equal to what? Real rate of interest, and we said that the real rate of interest is what? Was the rate of interest that would prevail in the absence of any purchasing power, parity, right? So we've got real interest rate plus what is dealt with Fisher's Law, which is the effect of inflation, right? We got through those, right? And then we did one more, which we said there were a series of other risk premia, right? And the first one we said had to do with what? Credit risk? And we kind of said credit risk or default risk really had to do with not getting paid back, right? And we got as far as, if I remember correctly, where we ended there, I sort of did a term structure of interest rates and did with rates and perceived credit risk, right? And we kind of saw something like that. Kind of like that anyway, okay? So so basically, given incremental risk, we should expect that there would be higher rate of interest, okay? So holding all other factors equal, credit risk is going to increase the cost of the nominal interest rate. Now, we started talking about rating agencies, and I kind of gave you rating agencies. Where we wrapped up was rating agencies ultimately, one second, let me finish a thought. Rating agencies gave us an independent opinion regarding credit risk, right? And default risk, and those rating agencies, although they're independent, are paid by the issuers of the debt, but they come in and they give investors an opinion on the perceived risk. So they look at company-specific factors and ultimately look at a lender's ability to repay, right, the collateral that's afforded for the loan and the cash flow that's going to be generated. They look at company-specific, idiosyncratic, right, not systemic or market risk associated with any debt, okay? And that's kind of where we ended. Angelo, you had a question.
Can you use the black mark instead of the red mark?
I could. I think I could. I mean, it's harder to read. I just picked it up upstairs, but...
Can you do a permanent one then?
No, permanent one, no. Let me see, this black one's from the house, I think.
So are
yes,
the,
Rosa.
The credit agencies, are there requirements for a lender? They're supposed to render an opinion on the perceived risk.
Well,
but are the companies, the banks, required to use the credit agencies? Because what happened is then they had all these ratings, AAA, BBB, whatever it was, and then they bypassed them and lied and...
Well, so... I don't know how much your partner next to you there is going to actually address this in his presentation on securitizations. He may or may not, so let's talk about it a little bit. I think there's a perceived conflict of interest in regards to the issuance of any financial opinion or advice, okay? So, let's back up. I deal this more in the accounting class, but... As it relates to audits, there's an inherent interest in that the company that's being audited pays the audit firm. Now, as a former auditor, the answer to that is well, listen, the firm has too much to lose. Their reputation is much more valuable than the fee on one audit opinion. Plus, they're professionals, okay? I think you can extend the same argument to the credit rating agencies. They're going to tell you Moody's is a standalone publicly traded company. Standard & Poor's is part of another, you know, very large publicly traded company, McGraw-Hill. And Fitch is owned by some French company. I don't even know who they are. But again, but their argument is going to be, we're not for sale. Mm-hmm. We're not for sale. By the way, today they arrested a soccer coach in Spain in second division for selling a game with four players. Second division, so not first. So they lost 12-0 on Saturday. You know, and then one of the players started talking. He was like, look, I'm not going to mention any names, but there are four or five guys that sold out. So people are always selling out, whether they're soccer players, audit partners, or rating agencies. But maybe not so directly, okay? So people get carried away. So here's the problem. The problem is the first rating agencies come out of a market need. The market need is people are issuing debt, but nobody is issuing any sort of thought or independent review on it. Okay? And so these companies come out and start offering an analysis, but who's going to pay? Who pays for research? We have the same issue with equity firms. Who pays for research? If you want an opinion, if you want a rating, are you going to pay for it?
If you need an appraisal, you have to pay for an appraisal.
If you what?
If you need an appraisal, if you need to get, you have to pay for the appraisal.
Well, that's another conflict because you're paying the guy, and the initials after his name say made as instructed anyway. So, you know, he's going to, but so. I'll get to you. We have to go beyond. So I think we have to be professionally skeptical, but we have to accept that, for example, in the case of a Moody's or a Standard & Poor's, the value of the corporation is much more than what they can make in one opinion. Okay? Because if we really doubt that, then the system is all a sham. But and I'm not. I want to get to that in a second. Yes, Angelo.
I remember a long time ago, I used to get phone calls from Dun & Bradstreet asking for me to pay them to do my credit profile. I said, no. I don't need credit, so why am I going to pay for that? Now, watching from... Who watched the movie?
Okay, hold on. Before you go to that, Dun & Bradstreet. No, but just listen. Dun & Bradstreet has a role and a purpose. But Dun & Bradstreet is not a credit rating agency in the context of Moody's or Standard & Poor's.
Oh, absolutely.
Okay, so different scheme, okay? All right.
I was going to say, who watched the movie with Brad Pitt? What's it called?
I haven't seen a movie in 30 years.
The one with the Big Short.
Yeah.
Did you always watch The Big Short?
No.
You didn't watch The Big Short?
No.
Are you serious?
You
great
seen.
Movie.
You didn't watch that movie?
You should never
no, of course it. I don't watch movies.
Wait,
no,
that's
you
a great
watch
movie
that
to watch.
Movie. Come on.
Movie.
I don't watch movies, okay, but come on, keep going. So what's up? Get to the...
That movie essentially describes how Moody and Standard & Poor's are being sold
okay.
by...
Okay, okay.
No, but I think they should, in the movie,
different. But listen, when we get to securitization, we'll talk a little bit more about this. But let's talk about two things.
Well, I guess my point is two risks. One is that are they doing the job, and then the companies, the securitized
okay.
companies, do they follow because they lied? So
okay,
there's supposed to be a AAA in the package.
But I haven't gotten to
right.
to the punchline yet, because your question was, I think your question was the banks have to get rely on them. Okay, that was the original question.
Do they have to get in? Do they have to rely on them?
Okay, so let's go through the process. So because nobody's willing to pay for research. Either equity or debt. Because as a consumer, you want it, but you don't want to pay for it. Okay, plus if you're the rating agency, how do you go around and charge? So it became a practice that the companies would pay for an independent research that would make the investors satisfied and happy. Okay, so that's how it evolved. It wasn't that these people were trying to shop their opinion or sell their opinion or throw a soccer game, okay? It wasn't like they were trying to they were going out of their way to make these as instructed appraisals, okay, or opinions. Now, yes, in fact, there was a lot of euphoria, and we'll talk about how or why in the security, when we talk about security, the securitization class 7, I think. Yeah, so there were some sort of ratings that were probably a bit too euphoric, and there were opinions that were rendered where maybe there wasn't the research that needed to be done, okay, or a true understanding of the security or what was the underlying collateral or the expected cash flow. So I'm totally with you on that, and I didn't see the movie, but I've seen excerpts from it and all that, and I know where you're going. But I can also tell you that empirically, there is a very long-standing support to, the relationship that high credit ratings yield a very low incidence of default, and very low ratings yield a high incidence of default. And so, while they may not be perfect, while there may have been errors, these guys have generally been on target. Okay, they generally have been on target. And they are continually reassessing, okay, and updating their opinions. And you rarely in this country, I don't want to talk about yours, you rarely in this country see a default that hasn't been telegraphed well in advance of its happening by the credit rating agencies. Now, that there was a window there from 2005 to 2007 where, especially with some very sophisticated instruments that were being sold, was there guard down? Absolutely, absolutely. Now, to your question, yeah. Banks in particular, cannot invest in speculative bonds, okay? And so, speculative in nature. And so, whilst for the most part, they're going to be investing in sovereign debt, U.S. treasuries, those U.S. treasuries also have to be of investment grade. And so, the US government, for example, is no longer rated AAA by Standard & Poor's, or rated AA, okay? So they've brought down the, you know, the rating on it, which presumably raises, you know, the cost a little bit, you know, from like nothing to just a little bit more than nothing, you know? But to answer your question, yes, and bond managers and fund managers and mutual fund managers very much have to adhere to the ratings that these people assign. And if you're an investment officer, you know, in a mutual fund or in a pension fund, you know, you've got a box where you can play, and you've got allocations where you can play, and you may be allowed a certain percentage into a high yield environment where you can invest in speculative securities. But for the most part, when you're safeguarding other people's, you know, funds, you're going to have to go into the investment grade securities. You know, so it may not have to be AAA, but it's going to have to be investment grade. Okay, that's kind of, and I'll send that to you after class with the summary that I did. There's kind of like a line in the sand between investment grade and speculative. Okay, and so yeah, people do need to follow that. So if you're in charge of investing at a bank, at a mutual fund, at a pension fund, you have to stay with investment grade, and that's why, you know, that's sort of critical. Now what happens is, like, for instance, you see a lot with REITs, they don't have their securities rated, and so then you get this whole gray area that, you know, are you investing in speculative stuff? No, it's not speculative. It's just not rated. And so, but then buyer beware, right? Then buyer beware. So, I'm not here to give you advice or not. You know, my personal experience has been, for example, with REITs, and with preferred stocks with REITs. You know, I've invested during some relatively, you know, down periods in a fair number of non-rated securities, and I've never had a problem with any of them. Okay? Now, there's no guarantee of that. That doesn't mean, but if you do your own analysis, if you understand what the companies are doing, you know, the rating is going to be relative as well, right? I think it's going to be relative as well. So that's as far as we got. But we said that there were some other premia that were involved in those, and that's what we're going to talk about today, in addition to some other things. Is that better? Angelo, is that better? The black, can you read the black?
Yeah, just make it bigger. There you go.
Big enough?
That's good.
The problem is my this black one's probably not that good. So anyway, we talked about, what were some of the other...
maturity and inflation.
Well, we got inflation here. Okay, and so,
on your risk, callability, convertibility.
So, callability. Let me see if this green one I got. Callability, convertibility, right? So let's go. Callability. Convertibility, and marketability. All right, so we're going to move on beyond credit risk and go into some of these items or issues. Components
of
interest rates, of nominal interest rates. Okay? So, yeah, you forgot one. Taxability. Okay? Before we jump to that, as a side note, we'll talk about this a little bit later, but I had it in my notes and I thought it was important to mention it. Strips. Did we read about strips?
No.
Do we talk about tips?
Yeah.
We didn't talk about tips last week or strips, but do we know what these things are? I know tips is what you give your waiter at a restaurant.
Yeah.
But in the context of this class, Daniel.
Now, treasury, inflation protected security.
Okay, so the treasury, again, you know, there's always financial innovation. So treasury said, hey, to entice people to not lose, right, purchasing power, we're going to index securities to the rate of inflation. Now, how has that happened? It's issued at a specific coupon rate, right? So the coupon is not affected. What's affected is what? The principal. The face value of the note is adjusted based upon an index on a periodic basis. And so what happens is let's just say that the face value, the original face value of the bond or the note was 1,000, and we have a rate of 3% of inflation at the end of 1 year, that now becomes 1,030 is what you're gonna get paid. Same coupon, but you're applying the same coupon to a higher face value, you're gonna have a higher interest as well. So you're going to eventually be paid the inflated, right? You know, whatever the number is, right? The inflated face value, and along the way, you've got the same coupon, but it's being applied to higher principal along the way, so your interest is also indexed to inflation, okay? So that's one way that the government tries to entice people to buy its securities and say, we're gonna provide some protection against inflation, against the loss of purchasing power. Now, another, and this becomes very important, and we'll talk about why in a subsequent class, but somebody came up with, and now the government actually sort of standardized it, created these things called strips. Now, what are strips? What's the acronym? Separate trading. Okay. A separate trading of registered interest and principal securities. When we have a bond, right? When we have a bond, the bond, somebody wants to borrow $1,000. They give us a promissory note, right? And we give them $1,000. What do they give us in exchange for those $1,000? They make two promises, basically. What are those promises? What are those promises? Give me $1,000 now, what am I going to give you in the future?
Repayment.
What repayment?
At least $1,000.
You're going to give me, okay, so you're going to repay the face value somewhere down the line, right? On some sort of maturity day, you're going to repay the face value. What are you going to give me in the middle, in the interim? Not a dividend.
Interest
payment, right? So you're going to pay a coupon. So they promise to do two things, okay? They're going to pay a coupon and they're going to repay the principal at the end of a certain particular period of time, right? And so basically, so let's sort of jump to one of the slides. The typical note in this country, the typical bond in this country has a face value of $1,000, okay? And typically pays its coupon semi-annually, twice a year, okay? So if we were to take a 10-year, right, maturity, we're going to say that there are going to be 20 coupon payments, right, and one final payment at the end, right? Now, what a strip is each one of these payments becomes a standalone security. So you could buy just this coupon at this particular maturity, or this particular coupon at this particular maturity, or just this strip of repayment at that particular time. Well, why do we want to do that? We'll hold the punchline for another class. I'll tell you why. But in the real estate industry, this process of stripping becomes very important. Okay? Now, all you need to accept today is that there are investors who have different needs. Some investors need current income. some investors may need a particular payment at a particular time only. They don't want interest, they want a capital gain, okay? So they're willing to buy at a discount and receive it an entire amount, okay? They may not need cash flow along the way. So you just have to assume or accept that these strips correspond to needs in the marketplace, okay, that have created. And I'll explain later on how strips become very important in the real estate industry. The
can,
real
you say that, can you say what strip means one more time, please?
Separate trading of registered interest and principal of securities. I think it's in the book. I'm not going to draw any conclusions about whether you read the chapter or not, I'm just kidding.
I did.
So anyway, okay. So we're talking about, there are two types. So let's go, we're going to go jump through a bunch of different terms and all that. Let's jump through a couple of different terms.
Professor, one more.
Yeah, yes.
Once you start drawing, don't erase it immediately.
Oh, because it takes a while.
Yeah,
I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Oh, if you had been up there, this guy was talking. This guy was talking about when he was at Georgia Tech doing his undergrad, the guy would be writing formulas here and then erase as he went along, you know. Okay, no, that's fair. I think that's fair. So bonds in this country and in most places could be one of two things. They could be coupon, or they could be discount. Okay, so coupon we just described. The borrower makes two promises, basically. They promise to repay the principal at a particular point in time, and they promise to pay you an interest rate. A discount bond, you may have heard the term zero coupon bond, okay? Zero coupon bond is one in which there is no coupon. There is no periodic interest payment. There is a discount at the time of issuance. U.S. bills, so short-term U.S. government obligations, for example, are all discount or zero coupon obligations. So what happens is you give me 90 today, and I promise to pay you 100 in a year. And inherent in that discount is the implied interest rate, 10% or so, a little bit more in this particular case, okay? So make it 10%. Give me 90 today, I'll pay you 99 in a year, okay? Assuming it's a simple calculation, no compound. So coupon, you're paying interest periodically. Zero coupon or discount, you are loaning less or borrowing less if you're the issuer. Borrowing less now with a promise to pay a larger amount at the end. Does that make sense? No questions on that? Okay. On the run, when we talk about on the run, it's the current issuance of a security. Okay, so it's not seasoned. It's essentially sort of equivalent to, you know, an IPO bond. So on the run is a current issuance of a corporate debt instrument. Okay, we talked about that. Okay, so let's jump to taxability for a second. Okay, so when we talk about the nominal interest rate that someone's going to pay is going to be impacted by taxability. In this country, we've talked about the fact that interest is deductible by the issuers of debt, right? So we said when we were calculating the weighted average cost of capital, and we got to the debt component, right? It was a percentage of debt, right? Multiplied by the cost of the debt, multiplied by what? 1 minus tax rate, right? Because we said the issuer can deduct the interest component from his taxation. So we've got to account for that. As it relates, and again, it's not a tax law, but as it relates to interest, when you are the lender in these particular cases, the U.S. Constitution basically has given the states the opportunity or the ability to issue obligations, okay, without making the interest on those subject to federal income taxation. Okay, so basically, the U.S. government can issue its obligations and charge the recipients of interest income tax. They've given themselves that right. But inherent in the Constitution is separation between federal and state powers or state authorities. States can issue obligations, and the interest on those is not taxable for federal purposes. Okay, so municipal or state issued securities, the interest earned on those is not taxable to the individuals. So when we want to compare things, we talk about a tax equivalent yield. So let's talk about this for example. Let's just say if I earned $1,000 of interest, right, and I'm subject to 30%, and I'm subject to 30% tax, right, there's going to be a $300 tax on that, right? So I'm going to net $700, right? But if I purchase a municipal or state obligation, right, what happens? I don't pay any tax, right? I make $1,000. So we go through this tax, we go through a tax equivalent yield in order to talk apples and apples, not apples and oranges, when we're comparing different debt obligations. So, for example, so how do you calculate that? So it's basically you take the prevailing interest rate and divide it by 1 minus the tax rate, okay? And that's going to give you your tax equivalent yield. Let's take an example, okay? So let's just say that the interest rate is 5%, and let's just say that your tax rate is 40%, okay, your marginal tax rate, okay? So 0.05, right, divided by 1 minus 0.4, 0.05 divided by 0.6, what does that give me? What does that give me, 0.833 or 8.33%, okay? And what that basically means is I should be indifferent to receiving or buying a bond that yields 8.3% that is fully taxable, or purchasing a bond that is 5% and is tax exempt, assuming my marginal tax rate is 40%. Does that make sense? Did I just say like way too much, or does this make sense?
Indifferent because it's the same.
I should be indifferent because it would be the same. Because my net cash flow at the end is going to be the same under this scenario. And so what happens is, because of this advantage, municipal and state issued obligations typically trade at a lower interest rate than taxable ones. Okay? Make sense? Any questions on that? Straightforward. Okay.
Municipal and what else?
And state and municipal. So basically non-federal entities, okay?
So we just talked about taxability. What's callability?
Well, not rework. You, what it basically says is you can call home, right? So I borrow money at 10%. Something happens. I mean, the easiest example is, I'll give you an easy example. I buy a house. Go to the bank. I borrow money. The mortgage is at 10%. Interest rates go down to 8% for whatever the reason. Doesn't matter right now. What's the first thing I'm going to do? So I'm going to call essentially the obligation, right? I've got the right to call it, right? I could just say, boom, here's your money, okay? Here's your money, give me back my note, okay? And I'm gonna borrow money from, you know, from somebody else, okay? So callability is basically giving the borrower the ability to prepay without any, you know, commitment or cost or obligation, okay? And so the fact that you have a right to call or prepay without any cost gives a borrower an advantage, but puts the lender at the risk of what? What we call prepayment risk, right? Which is, they put money out at 10, now when they get it back, they can only put it out again at 8. Now they've lost, right, some of the earning capacity. You say, well, that's tough. You know, that's just the way it is. We keep talking about matching and the importance. When we talk in a capital markets class, look, if we don't put ourselves in the position of our lenders, if we don't understand, you know, it's like with your customers. If you don't understand what your customers and what your suppliers go through, it's very difficult to run your business. Okay? So we need to understand, when we go to an insurance company, when we go to a bank, right, we need to understand what their source of capital is and what their constraints are. So, you know, just stop to think. A life insurance company. We talked about life and health companies being the logical lenders of real estate because of the long nature of their obligations and commitments, right? They're selling annuities. They're selling life insurance policies. They're taking so much money now, and they're guaranteeing a particular return to people. So now they've made a commitment to somebody. What are they going to do? Find somebody to pay that commitment. If I give that to you, and then 2 years later, you give it back to me and say, oh yeah, now I can't get what I matched there, now I got a problem. Okay? So, we'll get to the seventh class, we'll talk more about that, because that's a real risk or a real concern in the real estate industry. And you saw in one of the examples I gave you earlier today, it talked about something called lockout, and it talked about a prepayment penalty of 0.5%. So we'll see how lenders try to protect themselves from these, you know, from callability, you know. So ultimately, if a security is callable, right, it's passing on a little bit more risk to the lender, right? And so in theory and in practice, that security that's callable should have a slightly higher cost. Now, I'm not going to get into the math. There's something people go through, finance guys do something called OAR, which is not called a revolution, the musical group that you may know. It's the option adjusted risk or rate, okay? So there is a mathematical way to calculate the difference between callable and non-callable bonds, but I can tell you that there is a higher cost and there's a premium associated with callability feature. Okay. Any questions on that? Make sense? Mm-hmm. I'll repeat it.
No, not that, but would you, kind of my train of thought was different. If we had less, if we had more risk.
Option adjusted spread.
If it has more risk, it should be less valuable for the secure company than if it has.
The risk is for the bank, no?
Yeah, the risk is for the lender. So the lender's going to want a higher return.
Okay.
The problem is, we're talking about both sides here. Okay. Sometimes, a lot of times, we put ourselves in the mind of the borrower. We're going, yeah. That callability is great. Inherently, home mortgages are callable because we can repay them at any time without a penalty. That's not the case with commercial mortgages, okay? Because they've got call protection, because the lenders need to be protected, okay? So, but again, we'll talk about that. Does that make sense now? Yeah, cool. Okay. Well, what is convertibility?
Convert to something else.
Okay. So we've got a security that has certain features, but it can convert to something else. For example. Let's give me a real life example. asking me or you're telling me?
Can you work with different type of loan?
Yeah. The answer is yes. Daniel?
I mean, one example, which I've seen, a company is asking for is asking for a note for some sort of amount over a span of 3 years. At the end of the first year, they're willing to convert that note into a ownership or equity of the company.
So yeah, and it's exactly what Angelo was saying. So a classic one would be that a debt instrument has the feature at a particular point in time or upon the passing of a particular event to convert from being a claim against assets of the company to having an underlying interest in the company. Where do you see these things? By the way, so very typical with preferred stock as well. Preferred stock with convertibility feature to common stock. When? Well, sometimes it's just based on time. Sometimes it's based on certain conditions. Sometimes it's just based upon the discretion of the company. Why would people issue convertible securities? Well, because it may be convenient or the only thing that may be available to them at a particular point in time is a particular vehicle, and there may be a time in the future in which they would prefer to have a different instrument. I'll give you an example. There's a company out there called Frontier. It's a telecommunications company. So Frontier did a huge deal with Verizon where they bought a bunch of Verizon landlines in various markets in conjunction with one of the acquisitions that Verizon did. They had to get rid of this stuff. So these guys had to raise a ton of capital. They couldn't really do debt because they didn't really have the collateral base to provide. They couldn't raise equity because nobody wanted to invest in the equity. They raised a ton of preferred stock with convertible features at a particular point in time. And their whole thinking was, if we get to this point, we'll have generated enough sufficient cash flow. We will have realized cost savings and demonstrated to the marketplace that we're a viable business, and we're either going to be able to raise the debt that we need, or you know what, we'll gladly convert this to equity, even though there may be a dilutive effect, you know, on that. Okay, so you know that's a possibility. You also see it a lot of times in smaller businesses with high growth. A lot of times when the private equity firms come in, they will make their investments as some sort of debt instrument with convertible features for two reasons. One, debt has priority over equity. So they want to have less money at risk. They want to be able to directly have a claim upon the assets of the business if things don't work well. But they also want a feature that says, yeah, but if things go well, we want upside. Remember what we talked about? Debt typically has no upside. What's the most you're going to get in your debt? Your face value, your claim. What's the most you're going to get if you have equity, if you have the residual interest?
What they said, if the teacher wouldn't have cash, yeah, $12,000, he would have $120 million.
Yeah. So you get what's left after you satisfy all of the creditors. And the value of the business keeps going up, but what's owed to creditors is fixed, right? You're going to have upside here. And so what a lot of the private equity firms will do is they will structure their initial capital injection into the business as debt with some sort of preferred or some sort of mezzanine debt, but always with a convertibility to equity. You know, given certain parameters and given certain conditions. Okay, Daniel, you had a question or a comment?
Yeah, Frontier. Is that the company that's based in West Palm Beach?
No, Frontier's based up. Frontier originally comes out of Rochester Telephone, but they're headquartered, I think, in Connecticut now.
Okay, so I was curious because there's a company I know that is purchasing landline services and landline from the old Bell companies, Verizon, AT&T, AT&T, and one is now situated in...
Well, Frontier may. I know that Frontier bought a lot of the Verizon assets in Tampa. They bought all that Fios network in Tampa. I didn't know that they bought, that they were this close to down here. I thought as close as it came to Florida was Tampa, but they may have purchased something in, they may be offering some service in...
I might be thinking of another company.
It might be the same. I'll look it up. It's been one of my bad. This is, I always, you know, the psychology of investing, you only remember your good things, right? The reason I know they've got a preferred stock offer is because I bought that, okay? And it's not done very well, so. Anyway, now, because the convertibility feature typically is going to take you from a fixed or no upside return to some possible upside, in theory, you are giving the buyers of these securities some benefit, right? Some upside. So as a result of that, convertible securities typically have a lower cost. So that would be sort of a negative premium, right? There'd be a lower cost, okay, to the issuer of this debt for giving up that convertibility feature. And in practice, there's probably going to be some sort of dilutive effect on equity down the line. So there is a cost to them already, so they're going to pay a little bit less in the way of coupons up front. Okay? Yes, Daniel.
Another question. When they convert into from debt into equity, would that be an additional cost for the buyer?
No, typically, where you see, I don't know if you remember last week I was mentioning that shelf registration statement. I think you asked me how long a shelf registration was good. That shelf registration statement was, I forget what company it was now, but it was for One Liberty Properties. But it was for stock, bonds, warrants, subscription rights, and something else. So typically with convertible stock or convertible bonds or convertible preferred stock, what the variability that you typically have is based upon certain parameters, you're going to get so many shares. But you typically don't pay any more at that point. At that point, what you have is going to convert based upon the market value of the preceding 30 days. And if it's between this value and this value, you're going to get so many shares of this for so many shares of that, or for so many bonds, you know, dollar value of bonds. Warrants and subscription rights are marketable securities, okay? They're securities that give you a right to purchase something. So you may purchase that warrant, or you may purchase that subscription right, or it may come attached to another security. And in that case, what you're getting is a right to purchase something at a specific price. Does that make sense? So I may issue bonds with warrants attached to them. And those warrants give me a right to purchase stock at a particular amount. So in that particular case that I just gave you, the bonds aren't convertible, but they came with some warrants that were attached that give me the right to pay and buy certain shares. Make sense?
Yep.
We good? All good? We keep moving? Okay. Marketability is really just one of, you know, we talk about depth of market, okay? We talk at times about breadth, we talk about depth. And that's pretty simple. I think maybe the easiest way to explain this is when we talk about stocks and we talk about like daily average trading volumes. The more a security trades, the more demand that there is for it, the more marketable it is. You heard the guy talk today. It's no longer the case, but it used to be if you were on NASDAQ, you had sort of less marketability than if you were on a big exchange. That's no longer the case, but it used to be that way, okay? And so The more markets, the more reach, the more access to buyers, the more demand that there is from buyers, okay, the less risk that's going to be associated with a particular security. I think this is easier to understand in the context of equities. I worked for, when I was working, sold the company to a publicly traded company. We had a shareholder. It's very strange in a public trade. We had a shareholder that owned 37% of the stock in our company, and it was an asset management business, so mutual fund company. It was Franklin Templeton. So Franklin owned 37% of our company. We sold the business. The enterprise value was like $3.2 billion, and there was very little debt. So the bulk of that was, you know, the sort of public float out there. So imagine if you own $1 billion worth of stock, okay, in a company, you're basically holding a third of that company, and the average daily trading volume of that was like 10,000 shares. Can you really sell? I mean, you're holding hundreds of millions of shares. Can you sell? Not very easily. You're kind of stuck, okay? Now, you know, you can ask how they got there. It was a cluster, you know, whatever. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter why it got to be that in this case. But the context is they were holding stock that had a market. It traded on the big board, but it wasn't really that marketable, you know? And if you started selling 10,000 shares every day to not disrupt this, you'd eventually drive the value down as well, okay? So, but it happens with bonds as well. If you own bonds issued by the Henry County Solid Waste Department, there's going to be a lot less demand for that than if you're holding U.S. Treasuries. Okay, and there's going to be a cost associated with that for the issuer. Just, you know, he's not known. People don't know them. You know, they just don't have the reach. So that's it. Okay, and I think that's basically it as it relates to interest rate. I don't think I have really anything else to talk about interest rates. Any question on interest rates? We're good. Okay. I'm not going to spend time on swaps. But I will mention it. Swaps, are we good, D'Angelo?
Yeah.
So swaps are a type of financial instrument that fall under the umbrella of what we call derivatives. Derivatives are financial instruments whose value is derived from something else. They derive from an underlying something else, okay? We see swaps with currencies, okay? Okay, I think that's typically what we see them. So when we talk about interest rate swaps, which is what I want to talk about here, okay, we talk about interest rate swaps. We talk about somebody having a qualitative advantage over somebody else. But basically, what we're talking about is someone who has a fixed rate instrument, okay, changing that exposure to someone who has a variable.
Qualitative what?
Advantage. Somebody's got to have an advantage over the next guy. Otherwise, if both parties had the same access, for example, to a fixed rate, there's no transaction. But what happens is one person has a qualitative advantage, okay, over the other guy, and now he's got something to swap in exchange for a fee. Okay, I'm going to explain that a little bit further. So just for sakes of simplicity, let's just all come to the conclusion or the assumption that we believe interest rates are going to go up. If we believe interest rates are going to go up and we have a variable rate interest note, we may want some protection, okay? And so from that perspective, we may be willing to pay a premium to somebody, okay?
in order to entice them to swap their fixed rate obligation. Okay? Now, I don't want to get in any further than this into the mechanics of how this works, but understand that basically there are people. Remember we talked the other day about, well, we talked about the preferred habitat theory or the market segmentation theory. We said that different people like to live within the interest rate curve given, you know, a whole series of parameters that they had. So there are some people that may have an ability to borrow at a fixed rate at a low rate fixed, and they're willing to make some money and assume some risk. Why? Because of their asset liability balance. Okay, so there's banks out there, there are companies out there that are willing to exchange their fixed rate exposure in order to assume some variable rate exposure. So basically what happens is, in the case of, let's talk about in the case of real estate, a lot of times a lender is going to quote, or because their source of funds is going to give you a variable rate loan, but you don't want to assume that risk, okay? And so you go out there and you buy a swap. You swap, you pay a cost in order to convert that variable rate that the lender is giving you to a fixed rate, okay?
Does it go in the other direction?
Yeah, you could get burned by it, yeah. So listen, the nuances of how you go through this can get very complex, and you can make or lose a lot of money on this. But the concept that I want you to know is, in real estate, someone may quote you a variable rate, but if you're concerned about interest rates going up, you can typically, for a fee, swap it. Okay? Yes, Jordan.
I was going to say, in the low-income housing tax credit business, you're not allowed to have a floating rate for the long 15-year term that you're required to maintain low rents. So
because it could put too much pressure on your ability to hold the asset and then not be able to meet your obligation.
Right, so you could actually employ a swap to mitigate that, get rid of that risk, and just have a fixed rate, even if it's more expensive. In some cases, the floating rate's actually better in the short run, but you're assuming
risk in the long run. And right. what's happened with that is, I think typically a lot of the lenders are already going to come to you and tell you, hey, you know, we'll give you a variable rate, but here's a swap rate, okay? So they're already going to sell you the instrument. They're already going to sell you that derivative, okay? And it might be a different division of the bank or whatever, but they're already coming to you with a solution, okay? Okay. Enough of interest rates. Let's talk about debt instruments, debt contracts. A lot of sort of definitions. I mean, the book goes through all this. We'll just jump through some of these. We've already talked about some of these. Coupon, what's coupon? Coupon is the periodic interest rate that is paid by an obligation, okay? Debt instruments can be, they could be interest only, or you're only paying interest, right? They could be fully amortizing. So that means during the term of the obligation, you're paying both P&I in such a fashion as to, on your last payment, you have a zero balance, right? They could be, you know, partially amortizing. So, for example, you may have this is something that you see quite a lot in real estate. You may have a 10-year note, but you may be using a 25-year amortization period. So at the end of the 10 years, you still have a fair amount of principal to pay off. Why would people do this? Because the lender knows that the property can't throw off the cash flow in order to fully amortize it during that term. And they're willing to live with the loan to value that they've given you, you know, or the debt service at the property ratio that the property can sustain.
So they make it easy for your first 10 years.
Well,
to help you find.
But it's for the term of their loan, right? At 10, then you have a balloon payment, okay? A balloon, all right, or a bullet, okay? So in this particular scenario, right? In this particular scenario, they're gonna say, I'm gonna give you a 10-year loan, but at the end of the 10 years, you haven't paid it all off, but you're gonna have to pay me something, okay? Typically, the interest-only loans also have some sort of balloon, obviously, because you're not amortizing anything. Okay, we talked about, zero coupon, right? So we can also have zero coupon, so purely discount instruments, okay? There's no interest paid. You just pay a portion of what the face value is up front, okay? And you've got the discount rate built in. I think I mentioned, so in this country, the typical bond has a face value of $1,000, okay? And the coupon is typically paid semi-annually. Okay? We've got different maturities on debt instruments, and typically things that are 2 years or less, what do we call?
Short-term.
Bills?
Bills.
Okay. 2 to 10, what do we call? Notes. And greater than 10, what do we call? 10 or greater, we call bonds. So, I mean, there's no sort of technical or scientific, you know, distinction. Some people may call it a 10-year note, a 10-year note. Some people may call it a 10-year bond. But sort of this, the thinking is anything that's less than 2 years is typically talked about a bill. Anything typically up to about 10 is a note. And then beyond that, people call them bonds. In the context of U.S. Treasuries, most bills are discount notes or zero coupon, okay? All the other ones after that would be coupon instruments. Debt is typically quoted as a percentage or as a proportion of par value or face value. Okay, so a bond that has a face value of 1,000, when it's quoted, people are going to say it's trading at, for example, 104. Or at 96, which talks to the percentage. So a bond that has a par value or face value of 1,000 that's trading at 104 is trading, if you wanted to buy it, what would you pay?
Premium.
Okay, and that premium would be how much?
4%.
Yeah, so, okay. And if it's 96, what would you pay for it?
This is.
I'm sorry. Sorry, here. 960. Okay? Now, so does that make sense? So you typically won't see people aren't going to quote the bond at 1,040. They're going to say it's 104. Okay? Now, I won't, again, it's outside, I don't typically talk about this. Typically, when you buy a bond, you're also paying the accrued interest that the seller had. When you buy stocks, okay, so do you guys know how you get dividends? This is outside, but I don't think I cover this anywhere else. So when do you get dividends from a company? Okay, when a company declares them, right? The board of directors declares dividends, right? So they're gonna, what are the key dates? What do they say? So they declare dividends to the owners of record. So they say, we're going to pay 25 cents per share to the owners of record on 12/31/X1, and we're going to pay that on January 15/X2. Okay? So whoever owns the stock that day, okay, the day it goes X, it's now trading X dividend, okay? No longer with a dividend, okay?
If you owned it that day, you get the dividend. If you owned it this day and you sold it, you don't get the dividend. The guy that bought it is the guy that gets the dividend. If you sell it here, but you owned it that day, this guy doesn't get the dividend, you get the dividend. The guy that owns the stock the day of the owner's, you know, the ex-dividend date, the day of record, is the guy that gets the dividend. And there's no proration. You own it that day, you get it. It's binary. You get it or you don't get it. Bonds work different. And typically in this country, companies, public companies pay dividend how often? How frequently?
Quarterly.
Some companies, some REITs pay monthly. Internationally, it's a little different. In Europe, you tend to see companies pay dividends quarterly. I'm sorry, semi-annually. And in most of the rest of the world, and some companies in Europe, they'll pay annually. They'll pay once a year. We just said bonds are paid every 6 months. But what happens with bonds is the practice is you are accruing the number of days that you actually own the bond. So if you own the bond, so let's say that it pays on 7/1 and on 1/1, okay? If you sell the bond on 10/1, you're going to sell it for 104 plus 3 months, or half of the coupon that's due here. And the guy who buys it has to pay you this dirty price plus the interest. Okay? I don't know if that's in the book. It probably is. I don't remember if it's in a book or not, but just so that you know. Okay. Fun facts for when you're having dinner with your kids. This is what they want to hear, Angelo, when you get home. You're saying this. Dad, what'd you learn today? Typically, the instrument that governs a bond is called the indenture. That's the sort of contract that you typically have a trustee that represents all the bondholders. So that way there's a sort of intermediary between the creditor and the holders of the debt, okay? And so, you know, just like with stocks, you've got like a transfer agent that, you know, records who owns it and flows the money through and redeems certificates and whatever. You've got the same issue with bonds. You've got a guy in the middle, a fiduciary, typically it's a bank, okay? And so they give you funds, you give it to the company, and then they pay you the coupon, and you distribute the coupon. And if there's any sort of issues along the way, they get involved.
What was the term that he used?
Fiduciary, it's a trustee.
No, before that.
Indenture?
Indenture.
Okay. Bonds and notes can have collateral or not. And this is where it gets really, really hairy and tricky in this country. And you've got some institutions like banks that get very, very, you know, sort of creative with these quasi-equity, quasi-debt instruments that they create, okay? The real distinction is there any specific collateral or security or not? Okay, so for example, in the context of real estate, a debt obligation that has security could be a mortgage, right? Now you can have like mortgages on not only real property, on land, but you can have it on improvements or on real property. Okay, you can have equipment or collateral trust certificates. Okay, so like an airplane, it's like a mortgage, okay? It's a security interest that protects your debt, right? Your investment, right? Your loan on a particular equipment. You see that with utilities. You know, you'll have equipment trust certificates that are issued with specific collateral from this nuclear power plant or whatever, okay? Or it could be a debenture. So a debenture
is a general obligation of the company that has no specific collateral, okay? And so if you look at the priority, right, let's say you're a Florida Power and Light, to say something, right? And you build a big power plant, right? And it's got like, you know, whatever, all these different things attached to it. And when they built this, say it cost $1 billion. And what they did is they put, let's build the capital stack for that for a second, okay? So let's just say they got $1 billion and they put 100 of equity. So they had to raise 900 of some sort of, you know, capital, right? So that maybe they issued, let's just go, they issued 100 of preferred stock, convertible preferred stock, okay? They issued 300 of debentures. Well, let's go in priority here a second. Let's say that they issued 300 of equipment trust certificates. So these 300 million have a direct interest in that. The company goes bankrupt, they're gonna get paid first. So that's up 500, and let's say that they did 200 of debentures. So the debentures don't have specific security, but they're next in line in priority. Okay, so company goes bankrupt. These guys, you can't worry about them yet. These guys get paid first. Let's say, for argument's sake, that this is, they raise 500 for this. So they're gonna pay this guy. Now there's 200 left. They're gonna pay the debenture, okay? Then they'll pay like accounts payable and whatever. There's a whole other priority. We'll talk about that in a second. But there's even a more junior grade, which is called a subordinated debenture, okay? So when you hear the term junk bond, when you hear Michael Milken, Drexel Burnham Lambert, who started the whole junk bond craze, the whole leverage buyout craze in the 80s, a lot of these instruments that are used in the high yield business are subordinated debentures, okay? And a lot of times these things are done in qualified investor mode, so people are buying these without full disclosure. So risk, more risk, a lot of risk, okay? Subordinated debentures. Sinking fund. A lot of times, we talked about all these other things. A lot of times when companies issue debt, they'll have sinking fund provisions. So you say, what's a sinking fund? Well, I think very, very early on, a sinking fund is, so let's say I borrow $1 billion to build this. Let's say I borrowed the whole $1 billion. Well, if you're a creditor, you're gonna say, hey, in 10 years, what's the likelihood that these guys are gonna be able to pay me $1 billion? Maybe they can pay me the coupon along the way, but I don't know if they're gonna have $1 billion to pay. So the original sort of sinking fund theory is, you guys gotta put some money aside every year, so at the end of the 10 years, you've got this paid off. Now, in practice, that doesn't get done. What gets done in practice is a sinking fund provision requires the issuer of the bonds to redeem a certain percentage every year. So they'll go out into the marketplace and redeem, call a certain percentage of the debt so that, you know, at the end, they only owe 30% of what the original issuance was, not, you know, the totality. Okay, I think most of the other terms I thought were important we've talked about. Convertible, we talked about warrants. Zero coupon bonds, floating rates, we talked about all that. Yeah, obviously, these instruments could be fixed rate or variable rate. I didn't say that, but they could be fixed or variable.
So what was the
On the run again?
On the run is just the current issuance of a bond, okay? Like a government bond. So we say, so if the U.S. Treasury is going to do an auction tomorrow, those bonds will be on the run, the ones issued now, okay, as opposed to something seasoned that you're buying secondhand that was issued 3 months ago and you're buying from somebody else.
Okay.
Okay?
So it's the first time that's been...
It's what's being sold now.
Yeah.
It's kind of like what the IPO equivalent would be, let's
right.
say. Something that's new. Yes, Ben?
I know Professor Porgy made an example of a savings fund where it's also equivalent to a capital reserve, where like if a developer gets a construction loan to build a new property, then the bank requires that the developer include a portion for an overspend of, let's say, 10 years, where they would have put a portion of their generated income to cover for the cost of, let's say, a roof replacement. So would that be
okay? Well, yeah, but so that's right. So you can imagine the context that I talked in debt of. If you originally conceive a sinking fund as setting some money aside so that at the end you don't have to come up with it, that's what Dr. Forgy's saying is you're building a capital reserve so that when a capital improvement is needed, you've got the resources. That's kind of like the same context or concept, but with bonds you don't do that. With bonds, you just retire a certain percentage every year. You don't set money aside
or discount.
To then...
Or discount it.
When you say discount it?
Discount the original value of the security. So...
Well, this, I mean... discounting, and as I maybe I'm totally missing what you're telling it there. Tell me, discounting is sort of, from the other perspective, I have something that's due to me, and I want to take it to somebody and exchange it for something less than what I'm going to get in the future. But when we're talking here about sinking fund, we're not talking about the guy that's due something, we're talking about the guy that owes. We're talking about the issuer,
okay,
the creditor in this case. So I'm looking at the other guy. So a holder of a debt instrument of a promissory note may find a market to discount that if they need money now. We talked about bankers' acceptances the other day, where somebody has a draft and a negotiable letter of credit and they discount it at a bank, and then that becomes a negotiable instrument that they sell at a discount. If you are a clothing manufacturer, for example, it's very common in that industry, in the textile industry, there are finance companies out there that will discount the receivables that you have from big brands, okay? But in real estate, or in sort of corporate America, if you need liquidity, you just sell your instrument. You probably wouldn't discount it. If you're a financial institution, you may enter into a repo, but you typically wouldn't discount it per se.
Okay.
We're gonna need to start a sinking fund for breaking out to a Douglas class.
So I wanted to. So we talked about. We've mentioned this before. There is an inverse relationship between bond prices and interest rates. And we can quantify that. We talk about Macaulay's duration. We talk about the effect of interest rates on bond prices. So Macaulay's duration is the first derivative of bond prices to interest rate changes. There is a curvilinear relationship that exists between interest rates and prices. It's not linear. It is not a direct relationship. Why? Do the math. I'm going to show you.
I won't bore you with the math, but there is not a linear relationship that exists between a 1 point change in interest rates and a $1 or X dollar change in the price of a bond. It's curvilinear. So you got to use derivatives in order to get what that effect is, okay? Approximate, people use duration. That's a term you'll see thrown about. A lot of times duration sounds like how long, right? Especially those of us who speak Spanish, that sounds like duration is like how long, cuánto va a durar, you know? But duration has nothing really to do with the maturity, okay? When you're hearing anybody talking, whenever you look at a bond mutual fund, whenever you're looking or talking to people about debt, people are talking about duration. Now, the thing is, there is a very direct relationship. There's a lot of different factors, okay, that affect this curvilinear relationship, okay? And so the longer the maturity, the more of an impact that a change in interest rate is going to have on price. And so from that context, if you think duration, the higher the number, the more at risk I am, that's probably true. And the shorter the duration, okay, the less at risk I am. Because in fact, the shorter the maturity, the less of an impact that there is between the price, the movement of an interest rate and the movement on the price of the bond, okay? Now, we're not gonna do any of the math here, okay? So so the easy way to do it is a formula of Macaulay's duration. It's a first derivative. If you really want to get technical, you have to do something called convexity, okay? And you know, convexity, which calculates a specific point, is the second derivative. I don't remember how to do any of this stuff, and you don't even know how to do any of this stuff, okay? But I'm going to show you graphically what I'm talking about in a second. Now, why did I bring this up? Why did I bring this up? It's very simple. There is an inverse relationship between interest rates and bond prices. Interest rates go up, bond prices come down. Interest rates go down, bond prices go up. If we issue a bond, if we were to issue a bond, okay, and we were to issue a bond today, and the prevailing market rate is 10%, and I'm a highly rated creditor, okay, I'm going to issue that bond with a 10% coupon, right? If general interest rates go down, what's going to happen? And I issued it for 1,000, right? Okay? If interest rates go down to 8%, interest rates go down, what would I expect to happen to the value of the bond? It will go up. Why? Because the amount of the coupon is fixed, right? I'm still going to pay 100 every year or 50 every 6 months, right? Now I need to find a price that yields 8% with that coupon. It's magic. It's easy. You use your calculator. That's what we're going to do right now. It's super easy. Okay, so I told you that this class only had one calculation. That's the one we're going to do now. So, but hold on. But don't get your calculators out just yet. You're going to get them out in a second, okay? Now, so what we talk about this here is if interest rates go down and the value of the bond goes up, we are now talking about a premium bond. Premium bond, because we're paying a premium over the face value. If the prevailing market rate interest rates go up to 12%, what's going to happen to the value of the bond? It's going to go down, right? I'm still only paying $50, right? I'm still only paying $50. But I now need to find a value whose yield to maturity is going to give me 12%, okay? And when we talk about a value less than the face value, what do we call it? A discount. So we can talk about a percentage of the par value. So we could say it's 104 or 96 or 110 and 97 or whatever. Or we can say it's a premium bond or a discount bond. A discount bond is indicative of a market yield above the coupon. A premium bond is indicative of a coupon above the prevailing interest rate.
One more thing?
Yes, sir.
Okay. A premium bond is indicative of current market rates that are below the coupon. Okay? And a let me write it so that I don't forget. Discount, okay, where the value is less than the face value, right, is indicative of a coupon, okay? Discount is one where the coupon is lower than the prevailing interest rate. And a premium bond, okay, where you're paying more than the face value, is indicative of a coupon that is higher than the prevailing interest rate.
Can you write that in English there so we can read?
Yeah, I'll repeat it so you can write it, because I'm not going to write it again. A discount bond is trading below the fair value, is indicative of a coupon rate that is below the prevailing rate. The prevailing rates are higher than the coupon. A premium bond is one that trades above the fair value and is indicative of a coupon that is higher than the prevailing rates. So, let's just segue into this. You don't need to memorize it, you just need to think about it. Let's calculate. Chris, can you just turn the one? Does that do it, or do we?
Yeah.
Okay, let's just do this. So let's take a look at an example. I have a bond. Here are the facts. Look up. Don't write for a second. Look up. I'll give you enough time to write. Let's look up. I have a bond with a face value of $1,000. These are the facts I'm giving you. The annual coupon is 10%. The market rate of return is 8%. What does that tell you already? Is it premium or discount?
It's a
premium, because since the market rate is below the coupon, it is going to sell at a value higher than the face value. If the market rate of return were 12%, it would be a discount. Why? Because the prevailing rate is higher, which means the value of the face value has to be, or the value of the bond has to be lower than the face value in order to yield that return. We're saying it's a lot simpler than just continuing to repeat it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay? Now, let's solve for this though. So here's the formula, you know, to calculate the price of a bond, okay? But you don't need to know that. Let's do it. So I don't know how to use the TI, but I know how to use the HP. I'll give you the keystrokes, and I'm gonna show you in Excel how I prove it. Okay? So, and we've got 10 years to maturity. So the question is, what is the price of the bond? Okay? How do we do this? If you have a 12C, this is how you do it. Here are your keystrokes. 20, N. N is a period. Okay? Okay, now you can say 10 years times 2, or you can just hit 20. Okay? So you can go 10 times 2, N. Okay? 4I. Why 4? Well, that's 8 divided by 2. The market rate of return is 8, but the coupons are paid semi-annually. Okay? The payment is 50. Why is the payment 50? The coupon is 10%. 10% on 1,000 is what? 100. How often is the coupon paid? Twice a year. So each coupon payment is 50. So The payment could be 50. We could also just say 100 divided by 2 and then hit PMT, okay? And the future value, what's the face value? 1,000. What do I want to pay? 1,000. If you do those keystrokes, that's the answer you should get. Now, if you got the TI, they're similar keystrokes, but I don't know them because I got a
17D, I got a
is this reverse Polish notation? That's what it's called. Reverse Polish notation.
I used to know everything about this machine, and then I stopped using it. I completely forgot all about it. This was awesome.
Did you make that up, reverse Polish notation?
No, that's what it's called.
Yeah, I was gonna say.
No, I didn't make that up, man. There's no ethnic sort of, you know, bias here. Okay, now, has anybody done it? You didn't bring a calculator, you have one, you didn't bring one. Do you have an app on your phone? No?
You can use this. I got an app on that.
Yeah, I'm just saying, you should. Now, if you want, I'll show you in Excel how to prove it. Because, like, your calculator's good, but most of us have access to Excel at some point. So, I did two things in Excel, okay? I'm looking for the price. How much are you going to pay for this?
The future value is $1,050.
Yeah, so somebody's offering you this cash stream. How much are you going to pay for it?
Yeah, this is easy. I thought we were calculating the bond price.
Yeah.
Is that what this is?
Yeah. So, let's solve this. Let me make this a little bit smaller. Let's solve this with Excel, okay? So. Let's just do this for you right here. So, on 1-1-2000, nothing's going on. Okay, I borrow $1,000. In 6 months, I'm going to pay 50. In 12 months, I'm going to pay 50. In 18 months, I'm going to pay 50. In 24 months, I'm going to pay 50. And successively down the line. Okay? So, these are the strips we talked about earlier, right? These are the different strips. So, I am decomposing that bond obligation. And on December 31, in 10 years, I'm going to pay both a coupon plus the face value. Okay? So this is the cash stream that bond is implying. The market rate is 8%, the future value is 1,000, the period are 20, the coupon is 50. We already figured that out, right? We're comfortable with that. So using PV in Excel, and you got the formula right here, okay? Use it present value in Excel, okay? So you could solve for the bond price using present value, okay? I-21, what's the interest rate, right? So let's just do something real quick so you can see all the different inputs. Let's just hit this here, okay? So, rate, 8 divided by 2, number of periods, the 20 that I have there already, okay? You can also do this by difference. I don't know, I don't want to tread on the investments or finance class, but I would probably do those things in that, but I'm not gonna do that here or whatever. 20, okay? I can put 20, I don't even have to point to that. I can just write 20 right there, okay? My payment, right? I can put 50. Okay? I pointed to a cell, future value. So I could put 50 here, you know, I could put 1,000, or I could just point to a cell, okay? All right? So you can solve for the bond value just simply using present value. Now, what I also did is to prove it, I did net present value, and I pointed to the stream, okay? So, just as an additional proof, okay? So, rate that I'm discounting at, 8%, and what's the cash stream? D22 to D42, sorry, okay, D42, D22, all the way down to D42, okay? And that returns the same exact value, okay? So you could solve for the bond value simply by PV. So if you don't know the keystrokes, you use Excel
and you solve for present value, okay? Or you lay out the cash stream and do a net present value calculation. It should give you the same thing. So three different ways to get to the, you learned three different ways today of how to get to a bond value. Net present value, laying out the cash stream, PV, just using the variables, or your keystrokes on your machine. Okay? Now, to show you the curvilinear relationship that exists, what I did is I built a little data table, okay? And so I just did a little data table and I made changes to the market rate of return, okay? Obviously at 8% with the $1,000 coupon, I'm sorry, the $1,000 face value and the 10% coupon, it's 1135. So you can see that we've got below 10%, we've got premium bonds at interest rates above 10%, we've got discount bonds. So I just did some exaggerations so that I could plot a curve. And so here you've got a curve, value to rate. Okay? Do it the other way if you want, doesn't matter. Okay, but you can see that the relationship that exists in movements is not linear, but curvilinear. Okay? And you can see if you were to actually play with some of these variables, let me see if it lets me do this, right? That's 6 percentage points. Yeah, you can see it right there, right? So the difference between that and this, right, is 585. The difference between that and this is 347. And they're both 6% changes. Right? So the difference between these two is $585. The difference between these two is $347. So you can see it's not linear. If it were linear, it would be the same exact difference. Okay? Good? We good with this stuff? Questions? Angela, you're looking at all this stuff, so I'm happy to stop. This is important.
Yeah, I got that.
You got it? So you're good?
Yeah, I'm just trying to
work. We're all good?
My keystrokes.
Okay, lights. Okay? That's your.
You got the keys over here, right?
Yeah, but I.
How many payments per year?
You have two, so it's 20 payments altogether. Let's do that after class, okay? I gotta keep moving. I want to cover what we got left. I'm happy to stay afterwards and go through that with you, okay? Now, that's it on this. Now, let's talk about bankruptcy for a second. Okay, there's, thankfully, I don't have a lot of experience with this stuff, okay? So, if I did, you know, I'd probably know more, but my stuff is sort of anecdotal. I don't really know a lot, but, so, I think one of the nice and interesting sort of bases or tenets that we have in our business culture society here is acknowledging and understanding that at certain times people can't meet their obligations. And the reason why there are still certain countries in Europe that are now just beginning to come out of the crisis in 2008 is that they either don't have the legal infrastructure to deal with or accommodate for these situations, or just culturally they don't want to deal with them either, or a combination of both, okay? In this country, listen, people realize sometimes you can't pay, and there's a way to deal with it, and life goes on, okay? And it probably just needs to be that way. I don't want to say that that's, it's kind of religious in a way, you know, it's kind of like, okay, you know, listen, you got to forgive everybody and, you know, you move on, you know, I mean, otherwise you're just going to have like, you know, this sort of like, you know, gnawing thing inside, God never paid me up, you know, and whatever, so you just got to move on, you got to move on, okay, so in this country we've got these laws that sort of govern that. I'll talk a little bit about how you get there, but the bankruptcy code in this country, in the U.S. legal code, has various chapters, okay? Typically what you are more likely to hear is when we talk about Chapter 7 and Chapter 11, is the typical chapters under which you would be governed in a corporate bankruptcy. The one big distinction between a Chapter 11 in a Chapter 7 bankruptcy is, in a Chapter 11 bankruptcy, you are trying to restructure operations. You believe that there's future value. So, whereas in a Chapter 7, you're gonna liquidate, okay? So, how does this all sort of work? There's a couple of terms that I think are critical here, okay? So, there's something called insolvency, and there's something called bankruptcy. So, and people use them like in a lot of different ways. So, what is insolvency? When you're insolvent, okay. All right, okay, give her a star. Is that what you're giving your little, preschool? Is it a preschool?
Yes.
Is that what you get, stars?
We don't.
Oh,
stickers.
We get stickers on the hand.
Stickers.
I could bring a roller for you.
Okay, could you get it? Is that really what you do?
Yeah.
Why, please bring me.
We
I want to give them some of my football players. Yeah, because I think
it
that's
goes
how
a
they.
Long way.
Yeah, no, listen, that's how this generation's grown up, the little stickers and stuff.
Might come off and they hit each other.
Maybe not some of our guys. they don't. So, anyway, so insolvency is when you're insolvent. Very good, Monica. What does it mean to be insolvent?
There's no cash.
Okay, so the problem is, and that's why you have to be careful, so you can go to Merriam-Webster's. Insolvency talks about two different things in Merriam-Webster's. It talks about not being able to satisfy creditors, but it talks about what, in a financial context, insolvency means something in accounting. It is the specific definition of insolvency is when your assets are less than your liabilities. Remember the formula we talked about, assets equal liabilities plus equity, right? So if we look at this here, right, and we say we've got assets of 100, right, liabilities necessarily need to be less than 100 in order to be solvent. So if I have 99 and 1, technically, accounting-wise, I'm still solvent, okay? When I'm insolvent, technically, is when my liabilities exceed my assets. Because now I've got, not only don't I have any residual interests in equity, I have negative residual interests, which don't compute, okay? So, insolvency is when assets are less than liabilities, technically. Now, you can be insolvent and not be bankrupt. Think of a bank. Banks got plenty of liquidity. They could be insolvent. In fact, in 2008, we had a bunch of insolvent financial institutions, but they weren't bankrupt. And what's the job of the regulators at that point was to keep them alive long enough, right? Because that's why I just want to. So insolvency does not necessarily mean bankrupt. You can be insolvent and still be in business. Okay? You can be insolvent, but as long as you got cash or you got a good shtick or a good song and dance, you can stay in business. Okay? Bankruptcy is a legal state. This is something, so this is a
a technical accounting term or a definition that means that things are pretty bad. Bankruptcy specifically means that you have sought protection under the law in order to deal with your creditors. Okay, so state of mind, legal state, okay? And the way I look at it, it was very frightening. The other day, Saturday, I went to work out super early and I left the key and it was like a dead body on the side of the road. You know, which is very, I mean, it was covered up, but it was kind of, you know, it was kind of shocking. And then when I finished, I came back and like I actually saw the legs and stuff. And then the next day I went by and I saw this blood. And the reason I'm giving you this whole story is, bankruptcy, like when you lose all your blood and you die, you can't come back to life.
Okay.
That's why. So if you hit your head but you don't lose blood, you might be in bad shape, okay? But you ain't dead, okay? By the way, you know, I found out yesterday what happened. Unfortunately, it was a guy like my age with a couple of small kids, and the guy, he went on a skateboard. I don't know him. I mean, I've seen him, but I didn't know him. And apparently the other night he went fishing late out by...
Hopefully without the kids, right?
Yeah, without the kids, but he was apparently hit by a car as he was skateboarding back home. Wow. And, I mean, the crime scene was there and all that. I didn't see a car, so my sense it was a hit and run. And I was telling Angelo before, within 200 yards in front or 200 yards behind, there's been five accidents in the last 6 or 7 years here. The others have been bicycles, but, and like, you know, all but one have been hit and run, so.
They can't do anything about that place?
They've already reconfigured the signage and the roads a little bit, but there's obviously a problem there.
Where is this at?
On the third bridge when you're going to Key Biscayne. Like literally on right after the third bridge. So there's when stuff happens, I'm not a traffic engineer, but when things keep happening in the same place and a road makes a big turn also, which people don't realize. Anyway, I don't want to talk about that. I want to talk about this. So anyway, so insolvency, accounting state or sort of a general state of malaise. Bankruptcy, you want to deal with a situation like this or similar. You can be bankrupt without being insolvent. In other words, you may have more assets than liabilities, but you don't have liquidity. All of your debt maturities due now and you can't pay it all now because you got to refinance some of it. Okay? So you go to the law, to the court and say, I need help. And I'm going to get your, and when you come here as a corporation, you typically go down two paths. You could say, hey, I want to restructure the company. I've got to restructure the capital here. And ultimately at this point, what happens when you come here, this guy is here to protect creditors. And so, couple things will happen. A creditors committee will be formed. Okay, so you part of going there is telling the guy, this is all the money I owe to all these guys. They get notified, and a creditors committee is formed to safeguard the interests of all of the creditors. A trustee is typically named, which may take charge of the organization to safeguard the assets, okay? And a lot of times what you see is this doesn't happen. The debtor stays in possession. The debtor says, hey, let me come up with a plan that satisfies you and these guys of how we're going to restructure these things, okay? So the judge may accept it or not. You could go here voluntarily or involuntarily. A group of three creditors go to a court and say, this guy needs to be under bankruptcy because he's not paying his bills, or he can't pay his bills, okay? But the whole concept here of this whole process is to maximize the return to these guys. And I can tell you, I don't want to say never, but what was that movie? You're a movie guy, Never Say Never. Was that the James Bond, Never Say Never?
Oh yeah.
Never say never. I never want to say never, but creditors are always going to take a haircut in bankruptcy, okay? By the time you get here, okay, and all the fees and everything and the disruption of business, okay, this guy's going to take a haircut and this guy's going to lose all or most of his equity, okay? All or most of his equity. So the whole process here revolves around trying to maximize what's available for these guys. And so that's where the question becomes, does it make more sense to try to restructure and keep the business going because this is a viable business? Or the way to maximize this is, let's sell all the assets and distribute what's available under 7, okay? Now, sometimes you start here and you wind up here. Sometimes you start with a debtor in possession and then the judge takes it away and gives it to a trustee, okay? And again, thankfully, I don't know a lot about this stuff, okay? There's other chapters. I think 9 deals with municipalities, 13 deals with individuals. So if you're an individual, you go to chapter 13, and then chapter 13 of the code is what deals with you. There's a new one now. It's kind of a sort of evolving thing, chapter 15, which deals with companies with international assets and operations, because now you've got problems with assets and creditors in different jurisdictions. And so this is kind of an evolving, you know, trend here, having to deal with different laws in different places and all that. But so these are kind of the major ones, 7, 11, 9, 13, 15.
Yeah, the question I had, I mean, you kind of answered it when you went on, but if you're insolvent, because your liabilities exceed your assets, but if you have negative cash flow, are you also considered insolvent, or are you more considered?
No, it's not a cash flow issue.
But I'm saying if you are negative cash flow, what are you more considered by classification naturally?
No, I mean, there's no sort of term for that.
Okay,
there's no sort of term for that, but if you have negative cash flow, you could wind up, you know, sooner or later in this situation, right?
Right.
Okay? Or you could wind up in a situation where, you know, you're still solvent, but you need to come to the bankruptcy court because you don't have the liquidity to satisfy your obligations in the time frame or in the term in which they're due.
It's like how American Airlines did.
But I mean, American Airlines, see, so here's the other thing, and this is an important one, you brought me to this one. A lot of times, for instance, retailers will use the bankruptcy court not only to restructure what would be the seeming debts, or American Airlines would go in to restructure union contracts, for example. But a lot of times people go into bankruptcy because bankruptcy court is essentially the only way that you can break a lease agreement. So lease agreements are contractually binding, right? But in bankruptcy court, you can actually have those thrown out. So a lot of times, and in the case of airlines, capital leases for airplanes are also a way that was, so they really were able to restructure a lot of things in the airline. Yeah, they had negative cash flow. They may have, I don't remember. But what they definitely had is a bunch of leases they needed to redo, and it had labor agreements that they needed to deal with.
I think it also forces, if I'm not mistaken, I remember somebody telling me with the real estate as well, they have to do a forced modification in situations where if they own property, they have tenants, and they owe more than the income coming in, they can actually force them to modify it as well, from my understanding.
Yeah, I've lost who's who there.
And that's in 11.
No, but you force who? force the petitioner?
Like, yeah, so for example, like if American Airlines owned a building and the building was only collecting, you know, let's just say for gossip's sake, $100,000.
Oh, you're saying that it could force them to restructure
the
leases
note.
That they've...
Yeah, so if they bought it back in the days...
I don't know the end. You may be...
No, that one I know for sure. A bankruptcy lawyer gave me that information when on a project. So it's just something interesting to add to it.
Interesting.
Well. Yeah.
Okay. I mean, I haven't seen bankruptcies of sort of real estate owners where you know, you might be able to take advantage of what you
well,
just
really
said and pass it away.
Once you can classify it as investment. It's just once you can classify it as investment, like, you know, like how everybody bought in the boom and they might have bought $2 million, today it's only worth $1 million and that mortgage payment is exceeding the rent tremendously. In a situation where you file Chapter 11 under restructuring, it's actually one of the benefits on top of the leases, they can restructure their loan. It has to be within the same time.
Well, that's why you would initially do it, is to restructure your debt obligations, okay? Now, the final thing, if you get to here, or if you have some sort of extermination or limit repayment of some of the debt, you typically go through the sort of priority that we talked about earlier, right? So anybody who's got specific security or specific assets is going to be paid first. The government, you know, so you owe, you know, payroll taxes or withholdings from people, okay? You know, then, you know, sort of debentures, subordinated debentures, right? And just general creditors, guys, trade guys. If, you know, mechanics liens sit somewhere in there, you know, because there's some sort of personal protection there. So there's a whole hierarchy of how you pay people off, but the reality is that all gets negotiated. And again, you're not going to see a guy necessarily getting 100 and a guy getting zero. You know, maybe a guy gets 80 and maybe a guy gets 5 or 3 cents or something like that, okay? But, you know, again, in the limited situation that I've seen, nobody wins. By the time you get there, nobody wins. Okay? Yes, Angelo.
The trustee is appointed by the bankruptcy judge, right?
The judge.
And all the fees that the trustees collect go to where?
Well, this becomes like an estate, okay? And so as he's liquidating assets, that's sort of going into the bucket that's going to help.
Yeah, but they charge fees.
Well, of course they charge fees, and then there's accountants and lawyers and all that are getting paid. But what's happening is, yeah, and the other thing is the one advantage that to sort of, you know, the priority to sort of facilitate a restructuring as opposed to a liquidation, any debtor in possession financing has priority over, you know, previous claims. So a lot of times companies are prepared to come in, you sort of package or prepare your bankruptcy, you line up your debtor in possession financing already, and you go already with a plan to the judge and you say, okay, look, GE Capital's gonna loan me so much, I've got a preliminary plan, but at least I've got enough liquidity and I've got guys that are gonna finance my receivables. So now there's fresh capital coming into the estate, okay? But, you know, to your point, so, you know, these guys would get paid before these guys. But whatever gets realized just all goes into this bucket, okay? And, yeah, obviously coming out of this bucket, all these fees that are being paid to the trustee and all of the other service professionals, plus then from there you got to pay the debtor in possession, your secured creditors, and the government and everybody else on down the line, okay?
But it's essentially designed so that the costs can be paid up, the costs of the process, the due process.
Well, so those, yeah, absolutely. So those are all going to get paid first, okay? What's happening while the debtor's in possession or under the care of a trustee, you're going to get paid first. Otherwise, the process doesn't move, okay? I'm not going to spend any time on, you know, high yield. We've kind of talked about that. High yield gives investors who want exposure to more risk a higher return. And a lot of times a high yield market
you know, comes in the absence of bank financing. Banks cannot assume a certain level of risk, and so it needs to go to an alternative fund environment, right? A hedge fund, a debt fund, whatever. And this is all a sort of changing environment because, you know, we've seen this whole disintermediation in the credit process, in the credit markets. And so what's happening is banks, because of regulation, are becoming a smaller component of overall credit. And unregulated entities are coming in and filling some of that role. Whether they've got the right premium or not for the risk they're assuming is a different story. Bonds, I mean, banks will do, sometimes to mitigate risk, they'll do what are called leveraged loans, which are like secured loans, like high yield loans, but then they'll turn around and package those and sell those. Or what they'll do is to mitigate risk is they'll syndicate loans. They'll form a club or where they'll be the leader, or they'll just collectively go in and loan 100 and then sell off bits of the risk. That happens all the time. All the real estate loans locally that are done, underwritten by community banks, the Ocean Banks, the Mercantile Banks, the Bank Uniteds, what used to be City National, whatever, you know, the Chilean Bank, BCI, or whatever it's called. You know, if those banks do an $80 million loan, they're probably holding on to 20 and selling off, you know, the other, you know, 30 or 40 to one another. So they're all sort of distributing the risk that way. The credit bond markets are institutional in nature. Okay, they are institutional in nature. They are not really markets for individuals. Now, they're starting to be. There's a portal the U.S. government has now. You can create your own account. You can buy U.S. treasuries directly online. Most brokerage houses are now starting to have. There's people starting to set up exchanges where you can sort of buy debt instruments. But for the most part, it's a, you know, I'm going to call over the counter or, you know, type transaction. It you know, and so it's institutional in nature. And there's a certain number we'll talk about. There's a certain number of, you know, guys that play in it. The last thing I was going to say is euro currency. A lot of times you'll hear, so euro currency doesn't mean euros. Euro currencies mean that instruments are denominated in a specific currency outside of their home country. So, for example, a euro dollar debt offering is a debt offering issued in or denominated in U.S. dollars issued outside the United States. A euro-yen issuance is a issuance denominated in yen issued outside of Japan. So typically it would be a Japanese company that borrows in yen or the equivalent of yen in some external market. Okay, so that's what that means. And the last topic for today is preferred debt. I'm sorry, preferred stock. And preferred stock we've talked about pretty much. So it's an intermediary class that does not have the security that debt has, but it has a priority in the capital structure. It has a priority in the residual interest. So in a scenario like this, right? You would have assets, you would have liabilities, and within what is equity, you would have a preferred stock component and a common stock component. Preferred stock has some features that debt has. It has a coupon. It may have convertibility features. It may have call features, okay? Etc. But it doesn't have the same security because it doesn't have a claim on an asset of the company. Now, once all of these claims are satisfied, before things get distributed to the equity holders, the preferred would get his face value back first. Okay? In this country, most preferred stock is issued in $25 face value. Okay? But not all. There's some out there that aren't, but most of them, each share trades at 25. Okay, and it, and it trades like a debt instrument. It's interest rate sensitive, okay? There's no real upside. It's just gonna go up and down based upon the relationship that we talked about before between market rates and the coupon that it pays, okay? From a corporate perspective, corporations who own preferred stock, who own preferred stock of other companies, don't pay tax on their dividends. Because otherwise you could have triple taxation, right? Because then if they pay tax on that, then they pay tax on their corporate income, then they pay tax, then the shareholder pays tax on the dividend that's distributed. So corporations are exempt from paying tax on preferred stock dividends. But again, there's in the real estate industry, this is big. It's the one way that most REITs raise capital after initial public offering. They'll just do subsequent preferred stock issuances. Okay. They could have sinking funds. They could have sinking funds. All right. They could be perpetual. I think they're all fixed interest rate or fixed coupon. They could have sinking funds. Could. Okay. Now with that, I have a perfect timing. So I've got. I gave you the instructions on the quiz.
Professor, I have a question.
Yes.
Do we have a final in this class?
Yes.
And now I have a proposal.
I don't know. Proposals.
Is it going to be take home or is it going to be...
Honestly, it'll probably be in class.
Will be in class? Well, I have a proposal.
Okay, but let's do the proposal next week because
seriously, this is related to the midterm.
Okay.
Just hear me out. I mean, if you don't like it, you don't like it. Some of us are really struggling with the schedule, not just because of the fact that we have a paper through to finish by Friday and then present on Tuesday, but some of us are, have a desire. I mean, I have a desire to actually go through all those 20 questions and take the time to learn instead of rushing through answers only 6 questions for the sake of this midterm. So I was wondering if the class would like.
Well, hold on. And assuming this were a democracy.
Yeah.
No. Okay. No. Let's keep going.
Of course. I mean, this is just an idea. Instead of us doing a six question take home class, and then make half of the class struggle through the deadlines, I would love to be able to hold on that midterm, postpone it, allow us to go ahead and answer all 20 questions in preparation for the final exam, because. It would give us extra space to work on these projects because I not only have this class but I also have Dr. Woodser's class on Thursday, which is also midterm. I have your paper. I have a marketing analysis class also with Dr. Woodser. Everything's happening at the same time. You know what I'm saying? It's just mind-boggling. And some of us work.
And some of us get hit by cars.
Yeah, right. That's the other thing. I lost a couple of days.
I don't know
if anybody else.
Well, I mean, listen. But here's a problem. Here's a problem. I can't push it back anymore. Okay. I can't. Ideally, we would be doing this in class, and time doesn't permit. The final is not cumulative, so doing all 20 questions now are not going to prepare you because. The final will only deal with the subject matter that we deal with in the next 3 classes. Okay, so, pushing this back any, we already pushed back the presentations, so now part of your conflict or your time crunch is that we push back the presentations a week. My recommendation is if you are crunched with time and you need an extra day, for example, with your paper, that you reach out to me and tell me what is doable, but I can't.
I'm actually doing pretty good with the paper. paper.
Okay.
I don't want anybody else, but.
Okay. Well, so. Okay. So, you don't want to see your questions?
I do, but I have a sitter that leaves like now.
Okay. Well, why don't you write down your numbers before you go? Okay. And figure out which questions you have. So, write them down. Don't start pulling phones out. I will. If I see somebody with a phone, I'm going to get an F. I'm panicking for other people, because I already know people are going to pull the phone out. If somebody shoots, there's a reason for that.
What is this, the lotto or
the
phone test?
For what? I don't understand.
To take pictures of the questions that they're assigned.
Everybody here has assigned different questions.
Everyone has different questions.
Okay.
Okay, so you got to think, you jot down. If you have a doubt, you know, shoot me a note. So you know the instructions. You've got.
Wait, so I don't know my student number. I have to look at my email for my student
number. I got it here. I'll give you your student number.
17.
That way, nobody knows what questions you have or other people.
That's good.
Okay, so listen. The only things I just want to, you know, just advise. I'm sorry?
You want to sign tomorrow?
No,
Friday.
It was Friday. So, take the time to look at those questions, and you know you can access whatever material you want. If I see Investopedia, you're gonna have a problem. If I see Wikipedia, you have a problem. If you're gonna have anything like that, and some of the stuff that, you know, use real sources, use the book, use the notes I'm gonna send you. Okay. Use your own critical thinking. You know, I'm looking, it's only six questions, so I'm looking for, you know, some substance. That's it, you can go if you want, that's all, okay? And that's it. And I mean, you know, good luck. There's no reason, everything's in your hand to do this well. By the luck of the draw, some of the questions are gonna be easier for some people than for others. But this was a random number generator. And I just, so if you got lucky, you know, it's like the guy with the military draft when he was talking before. You know, he drew, you know, day 300 and whatever. You know, he didn't have to go to Vietnam. So, so that's it.
Questions? I have a question. So, you know, not asking for any extensions or anything like that, but in your opinion, if somebody knows what they're doing, how long would you say
it should take? To do six questions?
Assuming that, you know, you were...
Assuming that you had looked at these before,
mm-hmm.
that you've done your reading, and you've paid attention. I mean, this could take you 3 hours to do, you know, max four. And I'll tell you what, you will have a similar final where you're going to have 4 hours to do it in class.
Open book?
This is open book?
No, for the final. So the final
we're
should be
talking open. About this right now. I don't know. Maybe,
well,
maybe
you,
not.
You brought up the final.
Yeah.
Maybe not. Maybe. But right now, you've got access to your book. You've got access to your notes. You've got access to... So even if you didn't learn it, they're right there. They're going around.
He emailed the questions
out. Friday and then the...
Oh, yeah. Oh, so now to your question. Yeah, just use the questions that I sent as samples. Now, mind you, because I am jumping to the final. Don't assume that that's the case in the final when I send the study guide. Okay? The questions I sent you as the samples, use those and those numbers.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Which means that if you really looked at it, you should already be prepared.
I'm going to the number.
Okay.
Just to make sure.
See? Okay, so I can look at my student number.
Yeah.
Know.
Yeah.
Can I see
Hold on. Andre, you going to talk?
Yeah. So I'm the one on the board. I'm the one without the number.
You're the one without the number because I didn't have your number until this morning or until this class started.
Yeah, I'm
Could we
turn it off?
Yeah, we can. So.